Krush Magazine. It's not just a magazine, it's a movement.
Okay, I'm here with Willie Taylor. How are you?
I'm doing really, really good. How you doing?
I'm doing good. I'm feeling really stir crazy. Like it's starting to hit me harder and harder every day. Is that how you're feeling?
It happens like that. It happens. Keep your head. We're going to make it through.
Right. Right. We just got to stay strong.
We have to. We in it together.
I can't imagine how this is on you just because I don't know how you even live life with so many things going on. Like you're everywhere. So how bad is this affecting you now?
It's really affecting me because a lot of things that I had going on were either canceled or postponed, whether it was movies or stage plays or performances, and everything that I usually do on the move was at a halt. And we're at a point now where we don't even know when it's going to open back up and we're going to be able to even go, because once they open it back up, who says the timing is going to be, you know, in near future when people feel comfortable even going back out?
Absolutely. And we don't even know what that's going to look like. Yeah.
At all, right?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Okay, let's take this all the way back, like, to the beginning, because you grew up in Chicago, right?
That's right. Born and raised.
What part of Chicago are you from?
Well, I'm from 77th and Morgan for half of my life, and the other half, when I started becoming, like, a teenager, stuff like that, we moved to Harvey, Illinois, which was a south suburban area to Chicago.
Okay. I'm actually from Decatur. Mm-hmm. Do you know where Decatur is in Illinois?
I know what Decatur is, yeah.
Yeah, I'm from there. So I'm always excited when there's someone.
Wow, so, okay, yeah. I know exactly what that is.
How did you end up getting into music and growing a passion for that?
Well, you know what? I think when it comes to musical passion, I can't speak for everybody else, but for me, I just feel like it hit me so early that, you know, nothing else really mattered around me, that it had became like my life, you know. So, and I think at an early age, even when it came from singing in church choirs, like, you know, a lot of people say, I did the church choir thing. I did talent shows, and I joined a group, and we started to try to take it really serious. I had my first deal fresh out of high school with Universal Records, with a group called Quiet Storm from Chicago. And, you know, that was my first, you know, we did it, you know, so I did that. I had videos playing on BET. And from there, it went to making a band. So I went to audition for the band, go all the way through that, make the group, you know, so then that was a whole nother stint of my life. And then from there, it went from world tours, awards, and all this other stuff. And we did that heavy for like 3 years straight. Then I went to film and stage plays. And I think that was me just growing and trying to, you know, reach out and grab other things outside of me doing solo music.
And did you always think that you would be going that far with it and be that successful? Did that take you as a surprise, or were you like already sure of yourself?
Let me tell you something, man. If you could have told me I wasn't going to be the biggest thing popping at an early age, I'd have never believed you. You know what I'm saying? So it was more so that was the thing that drove me. You know what I mean? So outside of the passion that I had, I knew that I had it and I was going to get it.
Did you have a lot of support from your family?
Well, my mom was an old school mom, so my mom always was more of a, you know, go to college and, you know, get your degree and, you know, do something that's going to make, you know, ends meet every single weekend, you know. But I had a different vision. And I think as I continued to go and she got a chance to experience who I am as a person and what I was going for as a person, I feel like she was able to let her guard down, and she's watched me do it for years now. Like, yo, you do not answer to anybody. You make your own rules and you keep it moving and you take care of your family. You know, I'm proud of the man you've become.
Do you feel like that's like an attitude that you have like given to your children?
Well, I always try to let my kids know that they can do whatever it is they want to do. I'm not going to pick what you want to do, but if you can see it in your mind, if that was your vision, you know, you got that vision for a reason. So hold on to it. And if you see yourself there, it was a reason why you see yourself there. You can get there. However, you got to be true to getting there, because you can't fall off the mission and think you're going to do a whole bunch of other stuff in between, because that's going to deter yourself from going to what your goal is and what you said you wanted to do. So if you're going to do it, you go ahead and do it. So if that's a nurse, if that's a doctor, if that's a lawyer, if that's a you know, professional athlete, if that's an entertainer, whatever that might, that thing might be, once you lock in and you say, that's what makes me feel good as a person, this is where I see myself, hold on to it and, you know, and go for it.
Yeah. And you have so many different things going on. You got the singing and you got the musicals and you got the acting and then you also have your family life. And, you know, just from Instagram stalking you, I can tell that mm-hmm. you seem to be very dedicated to your family as well. So do you have some kind of like secret on maybe being able to manage all of those things correctly? Because that's a lot of things to manage.
You know what? What you really have to do is you have to give them all their own time because they're all just that important. You know what I mean? So you got to find a time to make sure the kids are having daddy time, not just collectively, but individually. You got to find a time for your wife to be having that husband time where you're not with the kids and you just you and her. You got to find out that time where you got to be going and do, you know, that work you got to do. It's all these things got to be put into the right time. So if you can, and that's not easy. I'm saying it easy, but it's not easy. So, you know, by the way I'm saying it, don't take it as if it's something that I'm perfect at, because I'm horrible at it and I'm working towards getting better at it. But at the end of the day, it's just all the time, because everything has a level of importance and they're high on the level, on the list rather.
Absolutely. Gosh, that is so true. Yeah. And I think as parents, we're all working towards that.
Yeah, 100%, right? Because like the thing is, I think even as a parent, yeah. man, I think the biggest thing as a parent is the people that you would want to impress the most as a parent is your kids, because you know they're looking at you. And if you can impress them, like, oh, that's my daddy, then if you know you took their expectations of what they could even do to a whole nother level. So it's always good. So I don't really be caring what the public got to say, but just don't let me not be impressive to my youngest, because that's, you know, I would like for them to see me as impressive.
Absolutely. I mean, your kids are your biggest fan and your biggest critics.
Exactly.
I mean,
you know,
they're always honest.
They always there. So like, it's like, if I get that approval, then it's like, okay, yeah, I mean, it feels a little bit different. Like, okay, cool.
And with your acting and your musical career, is there one that you prefer more than the other?
I'm just a man of the arts. So, you know, of course, music has always been my passion. So no matter if I made a dollar from music, I would always do music. That's just in me. I always have a song in my head. I'm always going to have to get it out. There's always a true emotion behind it, and it needs to be gone. So that's usually how I, you know, operate when it comes to music. But on the flip side of it, I do find a lot of love in doing, like, stage plays and actual film. Stage plays, to me, kind of open you up and get you ready for film. Because film is everybody's there as part of crew or, you know, staff or, you know, something, you know, or talent or something like that. But when you're on stage, it's just you. You got one take to do it, and you hold a valuable part in the storyline, and you're doing it to an audience who's going to react if you do it the right way. So it's kind of like class for a person who wants to go to film, because it kind of gets you like, okay, I got to be on my chops. If I'm not good tonight, then I'm going to mess up the storyline for this entire thing. And if I say blue when it was supposed to be purple, then they don't understand and seeing down the line that it was supposed to be blue. So when they talk about something blue, now the storyline is off. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah, you're making me nervous just talking like that. Like, I would be so nervous.
Yeah, but it's a craft that's worth exercising, you know, if you want to get into acting at all. I think stage plays, and I think the younger generation really needs to jump into it and really pay attention to it, because it's a really, really fun atmosphere, and it puts you in the mindset of a television sitcom with a studio audience. So it's kind of that vibe. And you just got to perform. You're supposed to be funny, you better be funny. If you're supposed to be crying or upset, that emotion has to drive those lines for the audience. So it kind of gets you ready for the screen for sure.
And did theater come to you before being on screen?
Well, you know what? Yes, it did. Well, it was kind of a my first stage play was for Scream. So, okay. It was kind of like I didn't have that practice because it was going to Scream anyway. And it's actually something you can see now on, I want to say it's either Netflix or Amazon Video where you can find it. It's called A Fool in His Money. It's by David E. Talbert. That was my first ever time acting, period. So it was, you know, it was extreme, but I got a chance to work with such a great director. I got the chance to work with such great talent, Michael Beach, Sidney Heron from En Vogue. It was just a lot of great talents in that. Eddie Griffin was in it. So it was just, I was surrounded by so many great talents that it made me a better, you know, actor, you know, off my first rip. And it knocked all the jitterbugs out. So we had one take that we had to do with a studio audience, and then we did another one with no audience, and it went to film. So
I'm definitely gonna have to check that out.
Yeah, most definitely.
Yeah. And how did you end up getting cast on Love and Hip Hop?
Well, that was a strange way of happening because I had just moved to California and I had knew a few people on the cast anyway. So I just, they were hearing that I was in town. They hit me up and I was like, yeah, I'm in town or whatever the case may be. And then I don't know if one of them had something to do with it, was speaking up or saying that I was out there, but I ended up getting a call like 2 weeks into going to LA to record albums and get up these other things together. I ended up getting that call. And then I just was like, okay, cool. If I can make it make sense for me, then I'll do it. And then we end up, you know, doing it.
And how did you feel about Love and Hip Hop? Because it can be, oh my gosh, it can be so crazy and dramatic. My gosh.
it's super crazy and dramatic. And it's not for everybody. Let me get that out there first. It's not for everybody. It's not something that anybody could just do. Shit, my patience was tested. You know what I mean? So it ain't for everybody. And the people that it is for, they're going to test the limits. You know what I mean? So it's just one of those things, man. I mean, that I enjoy the experience. It was a 50-50 for me. Yeah, I feel like I had a necessary moment in my life, and I had to address it at that moment. And I felt like in that moment, you know, nobody wants to go through anything. But if you do, you just got to understand at that time, you got to take it head on. You got to grab it by the balls and keep it moving.
I like that advice. That's really good advice.
Now you have to, you know what I mean? Because you never know what tomorrow going to throw at you. You know what I mean? So what, you going to fold under pressure, or you going to be like, all right, cool, this is something that happened in my life. And me being a human being and making mistakes and doing the things that I do and understanding that nobody is without sin, or, you know what I mean? Shit, we all go through a stage in life where we just fucking up and we know it. You know what I mean? So it's just one of those situations where you know, and once you get to it, when you have to address it, you just got to go dead on. Like, okay, cool, let me catch it, address it, learn my lesson here, and keep it moving. And then you release it, and you find out was the thing that did you end up keeping the situation together? How much damage did it cause? And it caused damage, but it was necessary damage. You know what I mean? Necessary damage that you had to get to in order to get to the other side of your blessing.
Oh my gosh, that is so true. Gosh, you should be a motivational speaker. Have you ever thought about that?
No, I just be motivating my friends and giving myself a little of it every now and then, but I never really thought about it.
is there any way that for all the kids that might be in Chicago right now or anywhere in the world, can you give them like some advice and maybe some key qualities that you think that they should possess in order to kind of do as many things as you have done?
Well, you just, first off, don't be a scatterbrain. Don't be all over the place. Pick one at a time. Find out exactly what you want to do. Find out, you know, how successful you want to be in it. Find the things or other people who have been successful in what you want to do. Study those people, because some things that you feel like you're doing and you're the only person to go through, other people have been through it, and you can learn those lessons. So don't be shy. Don't shy away from the books and the knowledge of the people before you. And you just got to be true to it. Okay? If you're not true to it, it will show. But if you're real with it and you believe in it, something's going to come. You can reach for the stars and you're going to fall somewhere softly on the clouds if you don't get to number one. You'll be comfortable if you put that work in.
Awesome. That's perfect. So all of you guys have heard that out there. Make sure that you stick to that because that's great advice. Is there, can you tell me, you know, anything that you have going on right now that you want people to know about or tune into?
Yeah, I want to give a big shout out to Krush Magazine. I love the magazine. I love the people behind the magazine. Shout out to Mark. Had two beautiful women in my Cat Got My Tongue video, which is out right now, streaming right now, so you all can go watch that right now on my website, willietaylor.com. And the song is Everywhere Digital Music Is Sold. I have a new single called You Are My Life featuring Mr. Talkbox, produced by my man Cage here in Chicago. And that drops May 15th. So May 15th, I have that. Pre-orders go up May 1st. I'll be shooting that video, and I'm supposed to be talking with Mark about doing it with some Krush models as well. So, you know, we just, you know, that's my brother 100%. And, you know, anything he needs from me, I'm always here. And I've been appreciating him for years.
All right. Well, we appreciate you. Thank you so much for doing this interview. Thank you for being a part of our team. And just thank you.
Oh, no, 100%.
All right. You have a great day.
All right. You enjoy the rest of yours as well.
All right. Bye.
All right.